Good evening, early evening. Today, Bezrat Hashem, we will continue the series that I started before the corona crisis started. We had to leave it on the side until we had more urgent lectures to give. I would like to continue that series, The Psychology of the Mind and the Soul. This will be lecture number 2. You can, those of you who missed part 1, they can see it on my website, divineinformation.com, also in toranytime.com, on my app, Divine Information 2.0, in my Facebook pages, it was published, in the groups, basically everywhere. So, this will be part 2. I want to refresh your memory that this series is speaking about conscious, subconscious, behaving of people, but it's mainly, specifically focusing on relationships before marriage, after marriage, between people to people, why people do certain things. It's very, very important and productive series. It's a must watch for everyone who wants to improve his life and save it, save his relationship, save his marriage, save his raising children, make the right choices when he's dating. What's important, what's not so important, what's critical, everything that there's hundreds of questions that bothers us when it comes to these things will be answered in this series. This series is based on the writings and recordings of the number one psychologist in the Jewish world, was ultra orthodox, big Talmid Chacham, Rav Shlomo Hoffman, that's him, right here, he passed 3 years ago. He reached a very high level in the Israeli court system that judges in the Israeli courts did not make decisions about releasing prisoners on good behaving without his approval. That's how big he was. He had to evaluate these prisoners by speaking to them and decide if they're going to return to the crime or they're going to be good citizens once they go out of jail. This was basically his decision. He was very, very special. The biggest rabbis of Israel of the past generation did not make decisions when it comes to mentality of guys, of people in yeshiva, without consulting with him. There's many stories over here that we're going to reveal to the public. But we are now talking about the top expert in the world and that knew the entire psychology and also knew the entire psychology of the Torah, which you don't have it by any psychologist, specialist, Freud, or any one of those. They only know what human being thought it's correct in psychology, and many times they were wrong. Sometimes they were right, but many times they were wrong. Not only that they were wrong sometimes, actually their advice is causing damage to the spirit and to the mentality of mankind. Of course, I don't believe that they did it on purpose, but ignorance sometimes in certain things can create a very bad outcome. But when we speak about the psychology of God, how he made a man, how he made a woman, once you know the foundation, you know the way to connect, what's important, what's not so important, what to let go, what never to let go, what to insist about. So this is very important. I'm making a long introduction on purpose because we had a long gap between the first session to the second. On the next lectures, we'll go directly to the point. I want to refresh your memory that in the last lecture, we ended in the words of the Rambam, Maimonides, 850 years ago, in his important book, Shmona Prakim La Rambam, chapter 8. We explained carefully about the concept that finding your soulmate, finding who to get married to, it's not only a decree by God. Yes, it's true. Of course, he has a share in it. But it's your choice. You choose in the end if to get married or not and who to get married to. Remember this. It's not only Hashem's decision. Hashem will show and hint to you in any possible way who he wants you to get married to. He will bring the girl to you or the guy to you, will put you together, will make the right people come and give and makes the right offer. But in the end, the final decision will be yours. And the Rambam explained that it must be like this because we have 613 commandments altogether. And all the commandments are based on the free will of the human being. God gave people free will to do the right thing or the wrong thing, depend on what they choose to do. We are not animals. Animals live by instinct. Animals cannot choose against their own will. Never. If the lion is hungry, he will always attack the sheep or the zebra, whatever he has there. There's no way to ask the lion, can you fast until tomorrow and tomorrow eat it? There's no way. People are the only species from 2 million different kinds of species that can choose to do something that are not interested in. It's against their will. It's against their desire. It's painful to them to do it. They can do something like this based on what's right and what's wrong. The problem is that to know what's right and what's wrong, you have to be educated. You have to be educated not in science or medicine or economy. No, that's also important. You have to be educated in the book of God. He is the only one who can tell you what's right and what's wrong, not people. Every person has his own truth. You saw throughout history what people thought is the truth. Some people thought to kill millions of people just because of their color, that's the truth. Obviously, everybody has his own truth. If people would determine what's the truth, you're going to have millions of different truths. And obviously, you cannot run a system in a world where everyone thinks that the truth is something else. Therefore, we have to go to our Creator, the Creator of the world, who created us, created our psychology, created man, created woman, created the differences between them, as we can see. And based on knowledge, the more knowledge we will have about the creation and about the Torah, Torah means book of instructions, teach us what to do, what not to do, what's recommended, what's not recommended, what will have great consequences of our life, what will have devastating consequences of our life. And the more ignorant you are, the more horrible your life becomes. The way you raise your children, the way they are, the way your relationship is, the way everything in your life is messed up. It's not necessarily because you're evil or because you're stupid. It has to be a lot because you're just uneducated. It's called ignorance. Bur v'am ha'aretz. The Gemara say, en am ha'aretz chasid. You cannot be ignorant and be righteous at the same time. The only way to be righteous is to be very educated in Torah. And the more you learn, the more years pass by with learning of Torah and listening to the right speakers. I repeat, the right speakers. There's many corrupted speakers out there. They have to be very careful from. I have a list of 14 of them that they are soul murderers, which I constantly send to people and save them from those murderers who destroy the souls with a rotten ideology and teaching the opposite of the Torah for different reasons. They have their reasons, but we don't care about this kind of people. We want to teach the exact authentic Torah, regardless of politics, regarding of personal gains or anything like that. Okay, so the words of the Rambam concluded basically that everything is in the hand of God, meaning He decides if you be a man or a woman, you'll be handsome or not handsome, you'll be smart, not smart, rich, poor, who are going to be your parents, what country you're going to be born, if you're generally healthy, generally sick, all of these things, genetic diseases, things like this, nobody asked you. You came to the world with it. There's only one thing that is 100% in your hand, the conclusion of the last lecture, if to be righteous or wicked. To do the right thing or the wrong thing. It's based on knowledge and desire and the willpower. For instance, a lot of people know they're not allowed to smoke. It's very bad. It's killing the lungs, killing your performance. But they still do it. Why? Can control their desires. Very low power of will. Strong addiction to the wrong thing. Or food, or a lot of other things. If there's no willpower enough, and lack of knowledge, usually the person will always choose the wrong thing. If he has willpower and lots of knowledge, and while he's learning, there's another benefit that the Torah, it's like a spiritual antibiotic. It melts and kills the desires for the time being. When you learn every day, it's like, today I took my antibiotic, it kills the infection, spiritual infection. The evil inclination forcing you and trying to appeal to you in all kinds of ways, infatuations and illusions. Once you learn, it makes your vision clear. and he gives you the strength to fight with your desire and your weaknesses. The minute you stop learning for a few days, immediately there's a major drop in your spiritual level. Guarantee. There's not one time in history a chance that a person was able to become more righteous without learning Torah. Or there is no such thing that if a person learned many years Torah and he stopped for X amount of time, that it did not affect him to drop in his spiritual level. Because it's something, just the same thing that you can eat for 20 years and then 1 week you don't eat and you die. And people may say, wait a minute, but he ate for 20 years. So only 7 days he didn't eat. 7 days and he died. Same thing to the soul. You can learn, and one day you stop learning for a week and there's a huge drop in your spiritual level. All of a sudden you again become materialistic. All of a sudden again you run after food. All of a sudden you don't watch your eyes anymore. And you're not so honest anymore in the way you conduct your business. And the reason for it is because you stop with the antibiotic, which is the Torah, and immediately the infection started to grow on a daily basis. This is basically the conclusion of the last week. There is another part from the Rambam that I should have maybe finished last time. I will do it right now. And for us, and then we move on. The Rambam continue, and this is what he says. What the Gemara say, Ploni, bat ploni le ploni, that it was already determined who's going to be your wife or your husband by announcing who's going to marry who. Like the Gemara in Masechet Sotah, page 2, the Gemara says, this is by a way of a reward or a punishment. Sometimes you did something very big in your life, then Hashem wanted to reward you and he gave you the right person with great skills and great personality. Sometimes you are a horrible human being, you do horrible things, and after a while Hashem decides to teach you a lesson and he gives you a horrible soulmate that will torture you for the next 30 years if you survive with her 30 years or with him. So sometimes the reason Hashem pushed you to marry this woman or that man was as a result of your sins. And that's what now you're going to pay. The Gemara actually say three things saves a person from going to hell after he died. There is heaven and there is hell. And there's also kafakela. And there's also all kinds of reincarnations. Something will happen to your soul. It will be determined based on your achievement and the choices you made in your life. You are responsible to what's coming for you. That's one of the 13 principles of Judaism. That Hashem rewards the righteous and punishes the wicked. And everyone who challenges that is an infidel and he spreads heresy and is an enemy of God and the Torah. And there are plenty of people like this that speaks in places, and ignorant people share their videos and they participate in a crime. Because when they publish these clowns to other people, more people will be negatively affected. Therefore, you have to be very careful before you share a video of another person. Doesn't matter who he is. Doesn't matter how beautiful is his beard. He can look as Santa Claus as far as I'm concerned. Doesn't matter. The quality of a person is not determined by his look. It determines by his learning, by his brain, by his devotion, by his integrity, his honesty, and the rest of the things. And if he teaches correctly or not, you have to be very, very careful. So, over here the Rambam say that there is such a thing that you can get it as a reward and punishment. And the Gemara explained there are three things that saves a person from going to hell. One of them is if he suffers poverty all his life or most of his life, horrible poverty. He can't pay bills, have to collect money from people, getting the shame every day, maybe sometimes go days hungry. So if a person has this kind of life, that will come instead of sending him X amount of years to hell for his sins. Another option, the Gemara say, if a person suffers from his stomach, it ruins the quality of life. You suffer a lot from your stomach, it could be acid, it can be ulcer, it can be constipation, it can be all kinds of diarrhea and gas and pain and things that nobody understands. It can be mental, it can be physical, it can be both. And many people, the Gemara said, a lot of the tzaddikim suffer a lot from their stomach because this kind of constant suffering, always, every day, every time you eat, you suffer. Some people have a celiac disease, they can't eat five kinds of grains, all kinds of other problems. allergic to certain foods, cause all kinds of problems, they're not even aware that it's because they eat certain things. All of that falls into the category of machalot me'ayim, suffering from their stomach, and that's also saving a person from going to hell. And the third thing is a bad woman, a bad wife, rebel against you, disrespect you, never help, never cook, never clean, always burning your money, disrespect you. I'm not talking about doing illegal things also out there. I'm just talking that while you're with her, it's a constant torture. Everything she argue, everything she rebel, she's not mother, she causes you embarrassment, all kinds of other shame. A woman like this also saves the man from hell. It's interesting, someone asked me a week ago, and I forgot to look into it. Someone asked me that, what about a woman that got a bad man? Tortured her, abused her. All the things that I mentioned about the woman applies also to the man. Is it also saving her from hell? Common sense will say yes. I have to see if it's written anywhere. That's the question. Obviously, common sense, what's the difference? If the concept of living with a spouse that torturing you every minute of your life, that comes instead of the hell. Same thing will apply to a woman if she suffers from men. So I'm almost positive that the answer is yes, but Bezrat Hashem, I hope that by the next session I'll be able to give you a clear source for it. If it's written anywhere in the Talmud or in any one of the holy books, then I'll bring it up. I'll bring you the source. Anyway, we'll move on. So the Rambam say, Rambam continue, that Hashem put together people based on their actions. You deserve or you don't deserve. If there is a reason to give them a punishment, He puts two stubborn people, two angry people, two jealous people to fight and destroy each other. Always. As Chazal say, sometimes Hashem takes a mamzer, illegitimate boy that was born to a married woman that cheated on her husband, and illegitimate girl that was born the same way. One lives in one side of earth, the other one lives on the other side of earth, and bring both of them into the same place, like a wedding, or Sheva Brachot party, or something, and they came into the same place, and someone decided to do shidduch between them, and nobody knows that they are mamzerim. They themselves don't know. The boy doesn't know that his mother went with another man and he's actually a son of someone else. He thinks this is his father. And the girl doesn't know the same thing. I remember actually one time, one of my Baalei Tshuva, that somebody came and asked me a question about him. And he said to me, I want you to know that this boy is a mamzer. So how do you know? I said, well, my father lived in the same country with his father. You know, and the original husband of the man went to a jail somewhere in a different country, and she was alone for a few years, and he gave her permission to go with another man while he's in jail. How can it be? I don't know how stupid a person can be to allow such thing to his wife, but reality is reality. And therefore, this guy and another brother or sister that he had, they bought actually from another man, while the wife was actually married to the husband that he was in jail. So now we just found out that these two are mamzerim. Even though the Gemara says mamzer vadai, mamzer you have to know 100%, not 99%. In order for you not to match a mamzer to a regular Jew, in Israel they have a list, in the government they have a list of mamzerim in the religious section, of people who are known to be mamzerim, not to allow them to marry a regular Jew. Most of the mamzerim in the world, nobody knows about them. Either that no one witnesses, the women never confess, or even, even if a woman confesses, it's still not a proof, because there could be different reasons for it. But it's not the point now to get into it. But the point is that it's almost hardly ever can be proven 100%. Just because you saw somebody did something fishy, they went to some place or whatever, they came out of that place, there's still no guarantee 100%. The only way actually to witnesses is actually two witnesses who see them actually in the middle of the scene, which is very, very rare. But Hashem knows. That's the whole point. The whole point here that Hashem knows who is a mamzer. And therefore, he doesn't want the mamzerim to marry regular Jews because their children will be also mamzerim. So he put them together. Like this, they will have children, but there will be less mamzerim in the world. Also, the Gemara said that someone that is a mamzer will die younger. And nobody understands why sometimes so many young people die in a generation. One of the reasons could be, I say, nobody knows, only God knows, that because nobody knows the mamzerim, Hashem takes them young from the world because he doesn't want them to marry regular people and expand this problem of mamzerut in the world. And someone that we know that mamzerim, there's no reason to kill them young, because Hashem will put mamzer and mamzeret. We gonna do it. Oh, you mamzeret, let's do a shiduch, no problem. Let's move on. So the Gemara say, afilu mamzeret, one side of the world, one in the other side of the world, Hashem brings them together and make a shiduch between them. Ha, the conclusion the Rambam say, this is a letter I wrote to one of his students, ha, you learn, just like I explained in the Mishnah in Pirkei Avot, that whatever happens is what's, look, descends and the right thing in the eyes of Hashem, that's what he does. But conclusion of everything is that a person still is the final choice to marry or not to marry. Even if Hashem is very interested in marrying this girl, he may have different stupid ideas right now. Also, a person chooses who to marry. A person can choose to marry a goya. It's not a marriage in the Torah. His children are not Jewish. That's not a legitimate marriage. However, he can go and do it in a civil way, like many people did it. Obviously, how can it be from Hashem if Hashem says in the Torah that it's an illegal thing? Will he go against his own rules? Obviously not. Or a Kohen will marry a divorcee. Woman that was divorced already, now she fell in love with some Kohen, they get married. That's an illegal marriage. You understand? Brothers and sisters, they can get married? No, it's against the Torah. Even though now I saw in America that the court approved a marriage of a brother and sister in one of the states, one of the liberal, democrat, wicked states, just like New York, there are many other places like this with rotten, horrible, wicked judges, with horrible ideology, and wicked ideology, we should say, totally off the truth. And they say, well, freedom, freedom, everybody can do whatever they want. You understand? So here you go. So there are marriages that are not legit. And if it's not legit, you know, if something like this is not legit, then obviously a person was choosing to do something against Hashem's will. And when we speak about shiduchim, when we speak about finding a soulmate, we have to know that that's a decision that a person decides on his own. And like every other mitzvah, he can choose to do or not to do, to do right or to do it wrong. The same thing in soulmates. The final thing is, you chose to get married to this person. Yes, Hashem pushed it, Hashem suggested it, Hashem wanted it maybe, but you in the end choose to do or not, and sometimes you choose against Hashem's will. You still have this luxury, if we can call it luxury, to do whatever you want. Later on, you'll be judged for what you did. Yes, you can't get away with that. But for the time being, no interference with your choices. Now we have to know, we're moving on, what do we have to check when we're about to go on the first date? Before we go on the first date, what's to check? There's so many things in the list. Pride, ego, anger, jealousy, stinginess, you know, laziness, all kinds of problems. Bad ideology, what we call bad ashkafa. Financial situation, health situation, family situation, wisdom situation, education. So many things you have to check in a woman, so many things you have to check by the men. But the question is, what is the most important thing? What do we have to really check? Before we even go into the next investigation, what is the first thing that if it's good, let's continue. If it's not, there's nothing to talk about. That's what we have to ask. The answer that the Chazon Ish gave, one of the biggest rabbis in the last 100 years in the whole world, and many other big gdolei olam, big rabbis, based on the Torah, of course, first thing you check if the person that is suggesting to you, whether it's a woman or it's a man, do you like how they look? מציאת חן. They find favor in your eyes or no? Is she pretty enough for you? Is she skinny enough for you or heavy? Depends what you like. Is she short enough, tall enough? Everybody with his own taste. Color, color of the skin, color of the eyes, color of the hair. All these things makes different reaction by people. Some people like this style, some people like everything else, like food, like everything else. If a man likes the girl how she looks, she's not turning him off, he's not disgusted by her, now he has to learn everything else about her. Check, investigate, go, call references, check in the school, whatever people can tell him about her. And of course, while he's dating her, he will learn a lot more things about her. But there's no point of dating or even trying if he saw her. They show him the girl in the wedding, and he saw how she looked. She's too short for him, too tall for him, too heavy for him, too light for him. He doesn't like her face, whatever the case is. Or the other way around. Woman, same thing by a man, 100%. She likes how he looks, tall, short, heavy, not heavy, face. If she is disgusted by the way he looks, there's no point of putting people together if they don't like each other physically. Later, we're going to get into the spirituality, of course, very important. But if there's no physical attraction at all, there's nothing to talk about. That's not the right shidduch. However, sometimes there is a small attraction. Yeah, she's nice. I mean, I could eventually fall in love with her. Same thing, the girl. You know, I would prefer he would look a little bit better, I would prefer he would be taller, I would prefer some other things about my man, yes. But I'm not putting this image out of the picture completely. With some efforts, I can actually connect and actually increase the attraction. That's no problem. If there is something like this, there is a chance to try. What Gdolei Israel, include the Stipler also, the father of Rav Chaim Kanievsky, who definitely had Ruach HaKodesh, holy vision, was big, big Chacham and Tzaddik. He say, as long as there's no Tchiyah, Tchiyah means that you get disgusted by something, can't even look at it, you don't enjoy to be around it. As long as that's not the case, there is a chance to improve the connection. But if mamash, like sometimes he says, oh no, it's totally not my type. No, I can never be with a man like this. Oh no, no, I can never be with a woman like this. Don't even try, don't push, don't be stubborn. It's not going to work. You only make things worse. After they have metziat chen, they find favors in each other's eye. Of course, now you have to check a lot of other things. By the man, the most important thing is if he's connected to Torah, he learns Torah every day, he has the right ideology, the right hashkafa, and of course, the right midot. And you like how he looks, you have a whole package here. Of course, there's always going to be issues of money and families and who knows what. It's never going to be 100% perfect. There's no such thing 100% perfect. No such thing. Never existed, ever. Only Hashem is 100% perfect. Nothing else by people is never 100% perfect, even though sometimes it feels like this. Some people, it's very rare, got very lucky in their finding their soulmate. It looks like too good to be true. It's happening very rarely, if ever. But even if you really, really investigate deeply, you'll find that there's some little defects here and there. It's not going to be 100%. But if you expect it to be 100%, you're nothing by a fool. Because that comes from foolishness. Everybody understands we are people, we are limited, we're not God, that's it. By the man, ideology is critical. If he has rotten ideology, his ideology is very influenced by universities, he speaks heresy, he contradicts the 13th principle of Judaism. That's not a leader for family. That's not going to be a good father. That's not going to be a good husband. When it comes to religion, it's very critical. But let's first talk about a woman. What you have to check about the woman, assuming you like how she looks and you're attracted to her. What is the most important thing by a woman? Let's see. Rav Isaac Sher say to me, Rav Hoffman say, that by a woman, the most important thing is her traits, personality. What's the traits? Lazy or not lazy? Generous or not generous? Jealous or not jealous? Angry or not angry? Good heart or bad heart? Evil or not evil? All these midot, traits, ego, lots of ego sometimes, sometimes humble. By a woman, the midot, the traits come before hashkafa, before ideology. Not like by the men, before. Why? If she has a good heart and she's humble, she works with you. Women operates mainly from their heart. If they have a good heart, fantastic. You can reach anything with them. If it's correct, you push it, you show her, she connects. It's very much easier to change women's ideology from a bad one to a good one than to change the men's ideology. Because by women, the most important thing is the midot. So if you find a woman that is down to earth, she's not too materialistic, she doesn't have high ego, she's not an angry person, she speaks, she listens, she admits when she's doing something wrong, it's fantastic. Because everything will be based on common sense. You show her, you prove to her, look, it's written, look what the rabbi say, and she will change. If she has bad midot, it will be very difficult. Everything turned into a war, everything is an argument, every 2 hours is a fight. You didn't buy me, you didn't do for me, you didn't give me a gift, why come, why you made a comment. It's never going to end. But if the midot is good, it's fantastic connection. You begin to show her that ideology, what she thought, or the way they raised her in a modern, in a conservative way, in a too modern, orthodox way, it's all rotten. It's all a lie. And what they learn in the university, 99% of the time, it's against Hashem's will. It's nonsense. What we care is what the Torah say. And what the Torah say, the highest level of a man is a Ben Torah. Someone that is very knowledgeable in Torah. His whole life is Torah. Not smartphones and movies and sport and the rest of their nonsense. You have a Ben Torah, more important than a rich guy, or than a big doctor, than a pilot, or a businessman, or the president of the United States. Ben Torah is the highest level of people on earth. Should know it. More important than anyone. The Gemara says, Mamzer Talmid Chacham Kodem LeKohen Aram HaAretz. You have Kohen from the royal family of Aaron HaKohen. Aaron, the Kohen, the first Kohen. This Kohanim, the Kohen, he's Am HaAretz, he doesn't know Torah. He's a big businessman. He could be a professor in Harvard. He can be a great doctor in a hospital. He can be a great politician, a senator. It doesn't matter, but he's Am HaAretz, he doesn't know Torah. He never learned Torah for 30, 40 years in his life. So what happened? He's considered Am HaAretz. But he's Kohen. Now you have in a synagogue, he's sitting the senator, that is a Kohen, or the Prime Minister of Israel, let's say he's a Kohen, sitting over there, but he has no knowledge in Torah. And then you have Mamzer, illegitimate boy, that his mother cheated on his father, and that's how he came to the world. He cannot marry any woman. Single Mamzer, sitting in a synagogue, but he learns Torah for 30 years. Let's say he's 40 years old, from a young age, learned Torah nonstop. You have to give the Mamzer Aliyah before the Kohen. The president sitting here, the prime minister, and you have this mamzer, nobody wants to marry him, but he's knowledgeable in Torah, very big in Torah. You have to give the first aliyah to go up to the Torah to the mamzer. Mamzer, talmid chacham, kodem lekohen am haaretz. Mamzer that is knowledgeable in Torah is higher than a kohen that is ignorant in Torah. The Gemara says, if you want to marry your daughter to Am HaAretz, to someone that is ignorant in Torah, it's equal to tying your daughter to a tree in front of a hungry lion. Same way a hungry lion, bang, gore with his head, his victim, and then viciously attack the neck and rip him apart. Same thing, Am HaAretzot behave with their wives. Abuse, attack, insult, violence, disrespect, ungratefulness, cruelty. Why? Not necessarily because they are evil people, because they never understand what's right and what's wrong. what Hashem loves, what He hates, when to be quiet, when to talk, what to talk about. They don't understand. They're ignorant. All their knowledge came from nonsense, from people. We are talking about divine knowledge here. You can't compare diamonds to pieces of glasses. And this is what we are talking here. So when it comes to a man, if he's not Ben Torah, you have a huge problem. What's the alternative? At least make sure he learns 2 hours a day. That will save him. Two hours, it adds up. He has the right rabbi. He listens to his speeches, encourage him, lots of musar, ethics. No, there's something to talk about. You don't have that, it's a very big problem. Of course, by the man, it's also very important, the midor, not to be arrogant, not to be too proud, not to be jealous, not to be angry, not to be lazy, not to be an addict. There's a lot of problems with men as well. But remember, by men is critical, the ideology. There's a lot of religious people with rotten ideology. I've been speaking about it for years already. Some of them have beard and they look like Santa Claus. But they are 100% kofrim. You cannot count them in a minyan. Like the 14 guys in my list. And there's a reason for it. Why? They can fool a lot of ignorant people. Because they don't know to tell when they speak the truth, when they speak heresy. Most people don't know. They are admired by their wisdom, the university wisdom. They know about science, they know about politics, they know about this. But in between the lines, they push heresy against the principle, against the prophets, against the Rambam, against the Shulchan Aruch, against the Zohar. You understand? That's called heresy. That's called infidels. So let's move on. So a person going out on a date, first thing you have to check by the woman is her midot. Shy, has class, modest, break into your words, fights with you on every little thing. But you don't make an FBI investigation when you date her directly to ask her a question about her personality and her traits. The way you do it is by having a conversation. It's called Gilgul Sicha. You're speaking about Hainda. My cousin did this, my this. So I'm a friend. I used to have friends. I love this. I love that. There's a war there. Did you see what they do to the children? And through the conversation, if you're smart enough, you lead her or him, she should do the same thing, to the point that through the conversation, you learn about the person you're about to marry. You learn if she has mercy or if she has a heart of a rock. You're speaking about horrible things that happened. Didn't bother her. She changed the subject. Oh, you see tears in her eyes. Oh, what a neshama. Very good. Sensitive woman. Excellent. You see how she treats the food. You see how much she ordered on the first date. Even that it's important. Is she here to take advantage on you? She has already the thinking that everybody was born to serve me, include my future husband, or she's shy. You know, it's too much. Maybe we don't need. It's not relevant. Maybe you're the richest guy in the world. It's not for you. It really doesn't matter. But it teaches a lot about the person. You see how she talks about friends from her seminary when they ask her to help with homework or test, how she avoided it or if she runs to help. You see if she's volunteering in all kinds of places. You see how she treats her parents and her siblings and all that. From that, you learn a lot about the woman. You see what time she wakes up in the morning. You see if she goes to shul. You see how she davens. You see how she dresses. So many things you learn about her. After a few good dates, you get a very clear picture about good or bad, positive or negative. Some women are very empty, meaning the head is empty. No brilliance, no knowledge, no wisdom, no nothing. Only nails, nail polish, moles, high heels, clothing, fashion, again moles, another fashion show, restaurant, vacations, beach, Cancun, let's buy a boat, change my car, I don't like it. That's all they have in their life. All day you see them with their long nails on the phone, shallow, nothing to communicate with. You cannot marry someone like this, you big Talmid Chacham, it's going to be a disaster. It'll be the biggest torture. Obviously, someone will try to set something like this up. They're also brainless. Some women, very spiritual. Devotion, tefillah, don't buy me chaval, don't waste, let's go to Cancun for Pesach. No, it's not a kosher place. I don't want to go there with my children. I don't want my children to walk over there with naked people or Miami Beach. You see the quality of the woman from the conversation. Same thing with a man. Everything I say, woman or man, it's equal. Okay? Only thing that is not equal here is that by women, it's more critical to her traits than their ideology. And by men, it's the other way around. That's the only difference that so far that we have. And we continue. And when we speak about marriage, most important thing is to get a person that is not selfish and egoistic. Meaning is willing to compromise, or she is willing to work with you, to satisfy you, to make you happy, to sacrifice for you. That's not a bad thing. Some people, their ego, they look at it as a loss. No, no, no. The more you give in, the better you gain. The more you gain. And this is something that you can check by a few meetings, by having conversation. You see how she speaks about her friends, about homeworks, and how she volunteers. She likes to help. She doesn't like to help. Don't ask direct questions. Mainly you roll it in a conversation. You speak about other things, and from that, from her impression. Just the conversation about the political view. You go out with a woman. She's a fan of Bernie Sanders. That second, you have to get up and leave the meeting. There's no point of wasting another minute. This is the woman you want to be the mother of your children? Liberal, lefty, support abortion, support socialism, nationalism, all this nonsense of these Democrats, supporting Iran, anti-Israel, supporting gay marriage. This is who you want? You're not normal. How can you have a woman like this to live with her 4 years and listen to her nonsense in the house? It's going to brainwash your children, and obviously everything Democrat is against the Torah. So sometimes that's all you need. She said, oh, I was a fan of Bernie Sanders or Hussein Obama. You know that between you and if you're normal, this meeting is over. Now you have to see how you're going to do it politely and finish it. Same thing the woman, if that's the man she's about to get. Liberal, lefty, pro-Hamas, pro all these human rights to murderers. They're very good when it comes to the negative people to give them human rights. But political issues, some people say, oh, I disagree with their political views. But we get along very nice. That's a wrong statement. Political views show if the person is righteous or wicked. Don't get me wrong. The Democrats are rotten. The Republicans are rotten and corrupted and have millions of other problems among them. But when you have bad and you have something that is much worse, you go with the bad. What can you do? It's better this than the other one. The other one is 100 times worse. So by here you can see already the quality of a person. Right away, who's an infidel and who's not. So one more thing we have to know. It's written, it's about the Chazon Ish, that the first thing that you check in Shiduchim, that she's not a stubborn person with ego, that she's willing to compromise, she's willing to listen, she's willing to review her views or her decisions. Otherwise, life will be impossible. Otherwise, will be impossible. The Chazon Ish used to say, when they ask him about a shiduch offer, you know, a date offer, he said, check 4 things. Listen, Rabotai, this is the commandments here. 4 things. 1, good heart. 2, good midot, good personality, easy, comfortable to be with. 3, love of Torah. She loves to listen to Torah, or she is avoiding it. Her husband put a CD in the car. No, no, put the song, put the news. Shut it off. She can't stand it. Especially when this is a hard speaker that speaks the truth. She doesn't want to hear about modesty and about other things. So immediately she always shut it off. Or she doesn't want to go to ever to listen. Or as soon as somebody gets up on the stage and talks, she goes out to make a call. You can see right away if a woman is pro-Torah or allergic to Torah. She lets her husband go learn. No, no, don't be with me. I'll manage with the kids. Go learn. No, come on. I haven't seen you all day. I missed you. I know, but it's more important for me that you learn your 2 hours a day. I'll wait for you. Come back 11, we'll be together. You understand? So you see already through the nature of the girl if she's pro-Torah or anti-Torah. And the fourth one, if she's down to earth, not materialistic. Every person has some materialism in him. People love good food, people love nice clothes, nice cars, nice homes. Let's not fool ourselves. It's not a crime, especially not in this generation, to dress nicely, to eat nicely, have a normal, comfortable car. To claim that it's a crime will be a death sentence to humanity today. How many people will be left in the world? 500? That's it. However, it is a crime when it becomes an addiction. It becomes the main thing in your life. That's all you evaluate things with. You meet a person, first thing you want to know how much he's worth. The American style. So what do? First thing in a date, in a bar. Christine asks Chris, hey, what's your name? Hi, my name is Chris. Nice. Can I buy you a drink? Yeah. So what do, Chris? I'm a limo driver. 2 minutes later, she already moved on. Oh, I'm a brain surgeon in Columbia Hospital. Oh, yeah, wow, have a seat. Can I get another drink? What's the connection is based on? What can I squeeze out of you? That's it. Many times it clogs the judgment of the women or the men. It could be the other way around. They don't care anymore about the beauty. They don't care about the look. They don't care about a lot of other things. They are so materialistic that all she really cares is to have money and comfortable materialism. That's the reason why sometimes you find a 7-year-old billionaire marry a 22-year-old girl. It could be their granddaughters. You go to Vegas in the airport when you come out to this filthy place over there, Sodom and Gomorrah, you see it all over. You wonder to yourself, wow, oh, it's prostitution, okay. But there are different kinds of prostitution in today's world. It's just connection based on what can I get out of you. That's really it. Oh, and retailing, that you die fast, that I'll have a lot of money. That's why these women will not agree to sign a prenup, all these things, going to make a big show, why you don't trust me. Why? Because the only reason they get married is for this. Same thing as can be my man. Oh, she's a daughter of a rich guy. I'm going to be able to sit and learn Torah all my life. No one will tell me what to do. I enjoy to learn Torah. So I only marry her to be my ATM. That's also not a kosher marriage. Even though his reasons for it is good because he wants to learn Torah, that's not a kosher relationship. That's an abuse. That's taking advantage on someone. When you go into the marriage, you have to think, what do I do to make the marriage work? What can I do for my spouse? How do I make her happy? How do I make him happy? How do I compromise? What's not so important that I let go? You have to be generous. You don't check the bills every minute. You don't torture them. You don't cut their budgets if you can afford. There's a lot of mistakes that men do because of ego and sometimes the ignorance, sometimes basically foolishness. They make very big damage to their relationship and to their family just because of some bad ideas or brainwash that they got. Sometimes it comes from their mentality. By Middle Eastern guys, meaning what we call Sfaradi, many of the Sfaradim, they come from Arab countries. And the Arab countries, I don't have to tell you that the women worth basically nothing. That's the mentality over there. So they don't have rights, they can't even drive a car in some places, and obviously they can't get elected anywhere, and basically sit home and be quiet and do the laundry and just be ready for me when I need you. And that's basically the mentality. You can talk, and if the food is not ready, you are finished. You have to be a real servant. This is obviously not the way of the Torah. That's maybe by Islam that's the way it is, but by the Torah it's not like that. By the Torah, you cannot force a woman, if you're a father, I want you to marry this 60-year-old man when she's 16, because he's going to give $100,000 to the father, so he sells his daughter to be a wife of some. That's how it goes. Either do it or we'll kill you. We'll kill you for the honor of the family. That's not the Torah. That's the total opposite of the Torah. The Torah said people should not be married unless they like the other person, unless they agree. Nothing can be done by force. It's a whole different thing. So, because you have influence from the countries where you came from, or your parents, or you saw how your father treat your mother in such an aggressive way, that doesn't mean that's the right way. So you have to learn Torah to get rid of this Muslim mentality. That's not a mentality of God. So you have to know how to behave. You have to know how not to fight. You have to know how to abuse, not to abuse people, not to put them down, to control your mouth, to be, you know, to look at things in the right way. And it takes sometimes years. Same thing by a woman. A woman can also have all kinds of bad influence mentality. If she comes from very modern countries like Europe, United States, Los Angeles, all kinds of places like this, materialism is very important. College, master degrees, this degree, that degree, education. That's a poison sometimes to the relationship because it's horrible ideology. It messed up the whole thing. So a person has to be very careful. So the Chazon Ish put it in one sentence. One, good heart, sensitive, good, care, generous, run, calling, checking who is doing good. Good mother to the children, good wife to the husband, you're doing good, you ate, you're okay, you're sure, you want me to drive, bring you some. Good person, she good to strangers, she'll be good for you. Second, the second thing, midot nochot, good. Not too angry, not too jealous, not a liar, not lazy, not waking up at 12. Loving Torah, wow, I love this rabbi, wow, he speaks so strong, so good, encouraged. She shares, she sends. Can you speak to my sister? I want to sponsor a lecture. Many people, Baruch Hashem, waking up now to sponsor lecture. Lecture like this. Eventually go to 100,000 people. Multiply by 2 hours. 200,000 of hours of Torah for a few hundred dollars. Where are you going to buy a treasure like this of 200,000 hours of Torah? Each hour of Torah is 60,000 mitzvot. Each hour of Torah. 2 hours of Torah is 120,000 mitzvot. 120,000 multiplied by 100,000. Do you understand what we're talking? Trillions of mitzvot for a few hundred dollars. Trillions! You live 70, 80 years, you don't make trillions of mitzvot, you don't make billions of mitzvot, and you don't make millions of mitzvot. And you know what? You don't even make hundreds of thousands of mitzvot. And you know what? You don't even make tens of thousands of mitzvot. Probably the entire amounts of an average person that does mitzvot without spreading Torah a lot, maybe few thousands of mitzvot. Maybe 40, 50, 60, 100,000 mitzvot. In a whole lifetime, what you can achieve in sponsoring one lecture. And if it's for someone's soul, father that passed, brother that passed, all kinds of, or someone that is sick, that needs remedy, it's the greatest thing to do. But some people don't understand. They'd rather spend $1,000 on a non-kosher restaurant than to spread Torah to 100,000 people throughout the globe. Okay, so Ahavat Torah. She loves Torah or not. And Mistapeket Bemuat. I don't care what house we're going to get. Why? Let's not spend too much money. No, this house is too flashy. No, but every one of my friends have nice house. I can afford it. Why not? No. I'd rather not attract too much attention. Let's get a smaller place. It doesn't have to be the fanciest. No, I'll manage with this kitchen. This car is good enough. Toyota, $200 a month lease, it's fine. I don't need a German car. I don't need $1,000 a month lease. I don't want the most expensive. I don't want the most expensive coat and the most expensive diamond. Because if she's like this, you will have no life. Some parents murder their daughters by the way they raise them. Free credit card. Sleep as long as you want, no obligation, no commitments, no nothing, no problem. Okay, now she's 20, 21, she's going on dates with a great guy. He's going to be a great husband, but he's not rich. He started his career, started to work. Let's say came out of school, finally starting a job, even a good job. It will take 10, 20 years to become wealthy, no? Well, what happened right away after the marriage? She's going to go, oh, I want to buy this bag. How much? $600. Oh, I want to buy these high-heeled shoes. How much? $400. Oh, I want to buy this jacket. Oh, I want to buy this. I want to buy this. After a month, his credit card is already skyrocketing. After a year, the mafia is knocking on the door. She cannot change her lifestyle because her parents actually stuffed her with drugs and she became an addict. Not drugs, pills. Drugs meaning materialism. Free car, age 16, manicure, pedicure, vacations, this, that, free credit card. No, go and try to establish a home with a woman like this. Show me one time that it succeeded. If the man is a Saudi sheikh, okay, no. So anyway, there's plenty of money. You can be it's terrible for the soul, but at least maybe they can be together. He's not going to check the credit card because she spent $10,000 or $50,000 a month. Most Jewish guys, especially when they're young, they're not exactly Saudi sheikhs, you know. Then what happened? 6 months down the road, the person is in an anxiety attack, panic attack. Dad, I need $20,000. Why? Since I got married, all she does is spend money. I don't know what to do anymore. All day she ordered. Amazon became her second husband. Instead of doing Birkat Amazon, she does Birkat Amazon. You understand? So that's the reality, Rabotai. That's the four things the Chazon Ish spoke about. Of course, I developed it for us to understand what is he talking about. Four things. Good heart, good personality and traits, love for Torah, mitzvot, for holiness, down to earth and not too materialistic. You got those four, but our parents are divorced, not the end of the world. Sometimes it isn't better, by the way. Sometimes a girl that grew up without a father will be a much better wife to her husband than a girl that grew up with a father, psychologically. Why? Because her husband is not only her husband, in a subconscious, he's a replacement also for her father. And she's so afraid that he will abandon her, like her father died young, or left the house, or got divorced, that she will always sacrifice extra not to cause such a thing. It comes from the subconscious, naturally. Women like these, if their husband leaves them, it's like the end of the world for them. Why? Because it already happened once, and now it's about to happen again. It's the biggest nightmare for them. So sometimes it's a great advantage. Not everything that looks bad is necessarily bad. She's not rich. Big deal. Parnasa is from Hashem. Where is your emunah? Start and Hashem will help. How our parents that came to Israel in the 1940s, 50s, anybody had something? People couldn't afford shoes. My father, Alav Shalom, told me shoes that he was wearing, all his brothers wore in front of him. Meir and Nisim and Pincha, every one of them. Why? I said, how? So we kept fixing it, patching it. I said, well, how did it fit? Well, everyone is the same. I said, no, you cut the front. The toe's coming out. Nobody can afford to buy shoes. The food, the Brits were in Israel. My father was born in Israel. The Brits were in Israel, the police, the British soldiers. If you come out of the house, they have curfew, they shoot. On the floor, they scare you. And then they give you coupons. You come, you get a bag of flour, leave. Make bread at home and leave. That's it. Nothing. This is the kind of life they had. Some oranges from the trees and this. That's just about it. That's how people grew 15 brothers in one big room. There was no rooms. Rav Ovadia Yosef Zatzal, the biggest rabbi of our days, passed away a few years ago. He said that in one of the times when they used to mop the floor, he used to stand with the Gemara on a chair. There's nowhere to go. Go to the other room. Go upstairs. Go to the basement. Go to the garden. Where? Everybody lives in one room. Beds like this, they're eating, drinking. Hakol in one room. There's no other rooms. The bathroom would be outside in a little cabin. No. Water or hot water, jacuzzi made in Italy, imported marble. Rabbi, I didn't finish my house 8 years. Why? What's going on? It's very hard to reach the marble, guys. There's a waiting list. I cannot finish the house because you wait for specific marble made in Italy, full of coronavirus on it. You understand? So this is it, Rabotai. It becomes a mental disease, this material lifestyle. So Rav Ovadia would stand on a chair with the Gemara while they map the floor. Where will he go? I remember I used to go to my grandmother. There was a little bathroom outside, dark, no electric. You go with a candle, you put a candle inside, you go. It's very scary. I remember as a kid, it used to scare me to go inside and to use the bathroom for a minute. And how they used to take a shower, they had this tool, you fill it up with water and you spill it and it comes out. Slow with water. That's how these people use. And that's someone who has a shower in the house. Some people used to go to the bathroom away, hammam. There was no shower in the house. It was a whole different world. But today, it became very serious. That's, by the way, one of the reasons. A few different reasons. One of the reasons that HaKadosh Baruch Hu brought such a plague to the world with this corona to bring everything down because it was impossible anymore to go on with this world. Impossible. The level of materialism, all these fancy schmancy Orthodox Jews with their fancy vacations on Passover, going, spending $100,000, starting to buy German cars, going on business class, and the stomachs keeps growing. Hashem said, enough is enough, I can't look at it. You know, and that makes a lot of sense. Now, a lot of these people will reevaluate life. And some people say, you know what? Now I'm looking at spirituality different. We managed. Passover wasn't so bad in the house like we thought. We managed. It was actually nice. It was only the family. Oh, we never did one time in our life. There's a lot of in-depth trouble. Inside, you see a lot of light. Anyway, so our time is beginning to run out. So let's just conclude. So remember, this is now when you're going to check girl, what's the most critical by her, as I mentioned. Now we're talking about talent and traits. This is from the Vilna Gaon, one of the biggest rabbis in history, the Gaon Mivilna. This is the question. If a woman is very opinionated, she has opinions in everything, she must express her opinions. She sits in the court of heaven. She has to make everybody understand her opinions. And she is very spiritual at the same time. She's actually knowledgeable. On one end, she is knowledgeable. It's not that she reads, she knows, but she must, she's a rabbi. She has to say everything. And is this a good thing or a bad thing? She's too educated in Torah. She challenges everything. Rabbi speak in a shul. She has what to say. She writes a column about it. She wants to be man de amar. You know? The answer. It depends on her actual character. If she's a controlling person, full of ego, wants to put people down, always to be on the top, that's her real goal. Or not. If she's just smart and have a lot of opinions, no, you can live with that. Why not? Who's to say to be smart and to have opinions, especially if the correct one, is a bad thing? If she's sensitive, she knows how to behave with people, she knows to apologize when she's wrong, she knows not to force too much. This is the words of the Gra of Proverbs. Proverbs 1, verse 2. That there is a special intelligence only for personality. There's intelligence for everything in life, but there's a special department of wisdom for character, for traits, how to behave with people. For this, it's a whole school by itself. This is what we call human relationship, Yachasei Enosh. The Gaon Mivilna saying something big, very, very important to remember this. We have Sechel Yuni, intelligence, Sechel Yuni. We have Sechel HaMachshava and we have Sechel HaMasi. We have Yuni means to investigate, to check every little detail. Sechel HaMachshava means the thoughts, knowledge. And Sechel HaMasi, it's actually practical wisdom. How you actually succeed in what you do. Sechel HaMachshava, the Gaon Mivilna say, is how to control your personality. It's good to be like this or it's bad to be like this. It's good to dress like this or it's bad to be like this. It's good to give or you should keep it for yourself. All these things is intelligence, how to do and to control your bad traits. The explanation is like this. The Sechel Yuni, the deep intelligence of a person, is to calculate the stars, the movement of the stars, astronomy, math, science, medicine, and all these kinds of things. Shas, Talmud, deep conversation in the Shas, halakha lemaaseh, kinyanim, business meeting, business decision, court decision, basically choshen u'mishpat, what we learn in Shulchan Aruch for 20 years in yeshivot. This is called Sechel Iyun. Second intelligence is the practical one. This is what a person uses to create things in the world, to build, to sew, to write, a butcher, a cook, a tailor, a slaughtering animal, moel, a contractor, a builder, you know, everything like that. That's called sechel ma'asi. And the third intelligence is sechel ha-machshava, the intelligence of the machshava, of the mind, which is, you know, those three, the Gaon Mivilna explained, those three exist in a human being. And what is it that this is the spirituality of a person. The spirituality of the person. So the Gra, the Gaon Mivilna, the Chidush here, and the Gaon Mivilna, that is explaining now in the Sechel HaMachshava, the third one, that this is how to control the midot. Not just to learn what to do, to actually control the inyan of the midot. How to deal with desires, with bad wills, and you wish to do this, you wish to do that, but it's against Hashem's will. How to interact with people. They annoy you, they're not so smart, you don't have so much patience for them, they're not sensitive, they're careless, they're ungrateful, they're too good to you, everything, you know, according to the situation. All of that needs a special mind for it, special intelligence, special wisdom for that. Those three different kinds of intelligence doesn't mean that a person will have all three. If he's a smart person, he can be smart in one of the three or two out of the three. Doesn't mean he has all three. Right? So if, by women, which one of the three is the most successful usually by nature is the practical sechel, meaning to create things. She will always design better. She knows how to match things. She will cook better than a man. In general, of course, there's always an exception to the rule. You know, so she's going to do a better job. She has more patience. She's going to be a better mother. A father has to raise his children. Jump from the window after a day. But I say to one woman, she said, I'm going through a very horrible divorce battle. The husband wants to take custody of the kids. I say, I already gave a different woman an advice, and it worked perfectly. I say, there are two ways to fight. One, he's going to take a very expensive lawyer, which he did already, and you're going to take the same lawyer, and it will cost you $100,000, $300,000, whatever it's going to be. You may win, and you may lose in the end. There's another way. Tell him, just take him. Give him 1 month with the kids. He'll beg you with tears on his knees, please take them back. I can't take it anymore. Give him 1 month. Let's see how he raises them, how he wakes them up in the morning, feed them, make them breakfast, get them dressed, send them to school, pick them up. One needs to go to basketball. The other one needs over here. The other one doesn't feel good. Let's take him to the doctor. Give him 1 month. I'm too generous. I say to her, look, you're not rich. You don't have the money. You're going to start raising $100,000 from the community. Chaval, this money can go to... Just tell him, okay, have the kids by you. I don't want to go to court. You'll see how he begged you to take the kids. Now, she begged him to take some of the kids. They grew up. She can handle it. He doesn't even want to take them to be one or two of them. Why? Because this is the way men are. It's very difficult to raise children. It's not the nature of the men to raise children. Usually, the way they do it is out of revenge. Oh, yes, you wanted to divorce me. You did this to me. You did that to me. I'll go full forces revenge. But after you win the trial, who's going to raise them? How are you going to manage? Plus, the kids will keep screaming, I want mommy, I want mommy. It's going to start becoming violent and scream and scare, and the kids will get more paranoid, and then he himself will get to a point that he will not be able to function. And then, usually, the ego won't let to admit that it was a bad decision, so he's going to send a broker, a mediator, to tell her, look, there's something to talk about. Maybe you'll give up on this and that, I'll give you back the children. This is just from experience of dealing with people. Why? You want something you cannot handle. It's not your nature. Women, they're very good at it. It's their nature. They have so much patience. You can see sometimes when they sit with the kids or this, you wonder to yourself, they have patience to talk for hours. Conversation that by men will take 2 seconds, it can be 20 minutes right there by women. Same thing. One, he says something, answering something, it's over. two ladies speaks, 20 minutes, half an hour, 40 minutes. What do you do all day? What hours on the phone? Yeah, I spoke to her, I spoke to her, I spoke to them. They're like, you know, this is how it is. Rabotai, Hashem made the men different than women. Some things the men is better than the women. Some things the women are better than the men. We're going to go and continue with that, Bezrat Hashem. And the last thing I just want to conclude is that this is based on the words of the Gaon Mivilna. The Sechel HaMachshava is a separate Sechel. Someone that has Sechel HaMachshava, sometimes it's strong by them, some people it's weak by them. For instance, you can be a great cook that knows how to cook the best in the world, but no business will ever hire you. After a week, they all fire you. Why? Because you don't know how to manage with people. You have horrible behaving, you stuck up, you're angry, you don't have patience, you're sloppy. No place can hire you, even though you're very talented. You're fighting with the people all day. The boss say, enough is enough. Just get out of here. But I'm the best cook. I won an award. You are. But I can't stand you. Get out of here. But it's not enough to be talented. You need the actual sechel maasi, meaning tact. That's the right word. You need tact. Many people don't have tact. They say the wrong thing in the wrong time to the wrong people. I finish with one story that I once said in one of my lectures, and that will give us an idea what does it mean to have a tact. There was one guy, he got married. A year after his marriage, he was a very handsome guy. His wife was a very pretty woman. They got married, two young people. Okay. So now, he comes to me after a year, to one of the lectures. I want to talk to you after the lecture. Yeah, okay, fine. Talk after the lecture. What's the problem? That's when he said, I think my wife is cheating on me. So what makes you think so? He said, the truth, I checked everything, no proof. Nothing on the phone, nothing on the computer. I even followed her a few times. Nothing shows anything. So I said, so what makes you think like that? He said, because first 6 months of the marriage, we were together nonstop. It was perfect. And all of a sudden, she became very cold to me. She, you know, avoided me. She's, every time I want to be with her, she makes an excuse, my headache, this, that. Obviously, something changed. Experience with people, Baruch Hashem, I have sometimes even too much with the years and all the headache that you get when dealing with public. And by the way, Hashem gave me an idea. I say to him, let me ask you a question. Is it possible that maybe 6 months ago when she started to change, you told her that she gained weight? He looked at me. Yeah, because she did gain weight. It's true. I told her that. Bothered me. I said to her, Mazal Tov, your marriage is over. What? What are you talking about? I said, yes, you don't understand what a woman is. You know what it means to tell a woman that she thought she's the prettiest one for you after all the compliments you gave her before the wedding and after the wedding and this and that, that one day you take away all her pride and her beauty and you actually tell her that she's not as pretty as she was? Do you know what it does to the mind of a woman and to her heart and to her conscience and to her subconscious? You know, it's an atomic bomb. So I say to him, you destroyed him. Then I say to him, isn't it true now that she always hides herself with a blanket and she always walks sideways and she makes sure not to change clothes in front of him? He said, wow, you're a prophet. How do you know this thing? I said, no, it's nothing to do with me. It's simple common sense, tact. Certain things you can say to your friend. Hey, buddy, oh, you became chubby. Too much bread, no? Too much pizza. So he gets upset for 10 minutes and he moves on. Man doesn't sit and cry over it. But if you say to the woman, oh, too much pizza, what's going on with you? She may even give you a fake smile, but she's burning inside. And not only that, 20 years later, when you go to Shalom Bayit about something else, she's going to pull it out. Right here, was a couple came here, and the woman asked me to speak with her and her husband. And as they having this, they screaming at each other in front of me, then she said something about the wedding of his brother. He said to her, Ma, my brother married more than 20 years ago. What are you bringing it up now? Remember what you told me that night? 20 years later, it's still fresh like it happened an hour ago. This is the way Hashem made women. Some mistakes you don't make. Once you made that mistake, to fix it will be years. Sometimes it's not possible. Meuvat lo yuchal litkon. To build the Empire State Building or the Twin Towers took many, many years. To bring it down took minutes. Once it's down, to rebuild it, not always is possible. And even if it is possible, everybody understands, it'll be a long journey. Same thing over here. Certain things you never say. You don't say to a woman, learn how to cook for my mother. I'll take it to my sister, she'll give you some recipe. You don't ever tell her the food is stale. You don't ever tell her it's not hot enough, it's not cold enough. Even though it looks minor in the way you think as a man, you have to prepare and to learn the psychology of a woman to succeed with her. If you don't learn, you're going to murder your own life. You murder her, but you actually are murdering your relationship. You murder, everything. Plus women, the way they think also, the way they function, is when they're happy, the best comes out of them. When they're upset and depressed and stressed, the worst comes out of them. Nothing comes out. Not the food, nothing. Basically, she's not in the mood for anything. It affects the intimacy, it affects the atmosphere in the house, it affects the conversation, it affects everything. Why? There is something that bothers her. You should be the last reason to give a reason to be upset and depressed and worry. If she's in this kind of situation, you actually suffer. You are the one that will suffer more than anyone else. And you will bring it on yourself because you are ignorant. Because you never learn the psychology of a woman. You don't understand the subconscious of a woman. And you don't understand that by saying certain words, or for instance, not willing to listen to her when she talks too much, that's also a killer. Because she must get it out. And if you cut her short all the time, yeah, for now she's going to walk away, but it's going to build resentment. He doesn't care about my opinion, doesn't care what I say. You don't give her 50 compliments a day. Immediately she translated that you don't love her and you don't care about her and she's not even important. And if she wears something new and you didn't run to give her compliments about it, you didn't pay attention, you finished. Because the whole point was not to dress to wear, that she gets some kind of a... Or if she cooks something and you don't give her 50 compliments, how wonderful it came and how do you do it so great, and you ask her a question, where did you get it, and how did you think about it, it's such a great idea. This is what it is, Rabbi. This is an obligation from the Torah of a man to the woman. And the next lecture, Bezrat Hashem, will focus maybe more about what women has to do for their men. Until then, I hope the message was clear. Bezrat Hashem, this was the second lecture in the series. Please share it. Don't be selfish. Share it now on Facebook Live. Just repeat. People will go. By tomorrow, the numbers will double. Share it to everyone you know. Everyone that needs it. People that go on dates. People that are already married. And it's, by the way, not only marriage and dating. It's also a relationship between people to people. Relationship at work. Relationship with your manager. Relationship with your worker. Relationship with your partner. It's all the same ideas. How to treat a man, how to treat a woman, what to say, what not to say. This is a very educational series. Baruch Adonai L'olam. Amen v'amen.